Okay, good afternoon and welcome to the GatesAir Repack webinar. My name is Jay Adrick. Many of you know me from the industry over the last 50 years. I'm a technology advisor to GatesAir. And my colleague, Joe Cecilia, Joe is part of the TV product line group here at GatesAir, is also going to be participating in the webinar. You'll notice that there's a public chat box over on the left-hand side of your screen that you can pull up, and we will be doing a Q&A session at the end of the presentation. You can post your questions there, and we'll go through them when we get to the end of the webinar. Taking a quick look at the agenda, we're going to cover four primary topics. We're going to look at the spectrum rules and regulations, the reverse auction process. We'll spend quite a bit of time on the television spectrum repack itself, and Joe is going to do a deep dive on the impact on the RF plant. And then the two of us will join in on the Q&A session. So let's get underway and look at some of the rules and regulations related to spectrum that will be part of what you'll encounter with the auction and repack process. So there have been a number of what I'll call protective regulatory wins over the process of leading up to the auction through some of the announcements from the commission and the responses from the industry, reply comments from the various members of the broadcast community, as well as, of course, the NAB and the Association for Public Television Stations and other groups that represent broadcasters. The advanced reimbursement program, 80% of the reimbursement for a repack will be given to commercial stations and 90% to non-commercial licensees upon submittal of the appropriate financial plan, which is part of the construction permit process. We'll go into more of that later in the program. There's an expanded eligibility list for expenses in a catalog of reimbursable costs, and that's detailed in the liability report. Again, you'll see that later in the program. Better signal contour protection, but still not up to what the industry is expecting. Better protection for TV translators and wireless providers out, even though the auction's completed and repack is completed. But again, a problem for long term for TV translators. Consumer education costs are reimbursable for those stations that are involuntarily repacked. VHF stations can channel share on a UHF channel, and there are statutory protections for must carry and also on the relocation fund size. The auction participation, there are a number of options. First of all, for any station that's going to participate in the auction process, there will be a pre-auction application window where the stations are asked to show that they're going to participate and also at the level that they're going to participate. The options for participation are to relinquish your license entirely, basically go dark, to channel share with another broadcaster in the same DMA, to move from UHF to VHF, and the option there is either high V or low V, and if you're a VHF station, to move from high V to low V. All stations intending to participate in the auction will be required to register ahead of the auction. The applications need to include information about not only the level of participation, but also information about ownership and location, et cetera. The FCC has indicated they will protect the confidentiality of each station through the auction. There'll be a two-year window beyond the auction for those stations who did not successfully exit or move in the auction process. Channel sharing is, as I mentioned, an option in the channel share arrangement. The bidder in the channel sharing arrangements is the entity that's going to relinquish its spectrum. There must be a copy of the finalized channel sharing agreement submitted ahead of time. It has to certify that the move is to a new facility and it will not change the local DMA. It will provide full coverage for community of license or meet the FCC's table of allotment priorities if community must change. And on the reimbursement consequences there, the costs for channel sharing will come out of the auction proceeds. They'll not be part of the auction reimbursement process. There's also some post-operating requirements on channel sharing, such as the agreement has to include things like what's the right of access to facilities, the allocation of bandwidth between the two entities, the handling of operation, maintenance, modification of facilities, including the parties' financial obligations, and a termination or transfer of sale rights protection. And what happens, of course, if one of the partners were to lose a license and the rights of the other would then be unaffected. So it would be a case of the commission taking back the license and reassigning to the qualified licensee. There is an anti-collusion rule. All TV licensees, whether participating in the reverse auction or not, are barred from disclosing information about bid amounts, strategy, and this applies nationwide. So if you happen to know something within a group that you belong to, but it's not in your market, you're still not able to share that information. The exceptions are between two parties where there's a channel sharing arrangement, and the ban kicks in at the deadline for pre-auction applications. This says Q2 2015. That still remains to be seen because we don't have a firm date for start of the auction. There will be a consumer education program that any broadcaster that's moving to a new channel will be required to engage in that process. There's a minimum number of announcements that's made in a 30-day period prior to suspending operations on the original channel assignment. So we'll look briefly at the auction process. There are really two auctions going on. There's the reverse auction, which is the auction between the FCC and the local broadcaster that's selling its spectrum. And there's a forward auction, which is the auction that takes place between the acquirer of the spectrum and the FCC. The auction works in a what I'll call declining clock process, meaning that the highest bid amount will begin at the start of the auction and will ratchet down from there. And there'll be different amounts depending upon whether the station is going off the air or moving from UHF to VHF. Part of the ratcheting down of the price will be tied to how many stations in a given market are required to exit for the FCC to recover spectrum, and how many stations have actually teed up and said they would participate. There is an overall constraint that says at the end of the auction period, the amount paid out to broadcasters versus the amount taken in from the wireless people needs to be less than what's taken in from the wireless folks, and also needs to cover the $1.75 billion Repack fund, as well as another $7.5 billion that's set aside for public safety. And of course, the original intention was that there would also be funds left over to contribute to the deficit. So if the net amount is not sufficient, there are some elements of the rules that will enable the FCC to go back into the process and reduce the amount of spectrum being auctioned until they get to a point of equilibrium on the amounts. The broadcasters that are eligible for the reverse auction are all full-power broadcasters and all Class A commercial and non-commercial stations in the selected markets. The FCC wants to clear 126 megahertz. We'll talk a bit about that. And there is a likely case where adjacent markets or markets that are required to clear beyond the targeted markets will be involved in the auction process. So first of all, let's look at the clearing targets. In the last public notice, the FCC made it fairly clear that there are really two clearing targets, one of them being 84 megahertz. That's sort of the minimum amount of spectrum that needs to be cleared in order to have a successful forward auction. The maximum amount of spectrum that they're seeking would be 126 megahertz. Many of you remember that the original number thrown out was 120 megahertz. How they get to 126 is channel 37, which was never assigned to television service or television stations. It's in the television service group of channels, but utilized for radio astronomy and medical telemetry. That channel is also included in the clearing. So if 84 megahertz is the target, there are 104 markets that are likely to be targeted in the auction process. And this is based on something more than about 100 simulations that have been done already by the FCC. If it's 126 megahertz, that will increase the number of targeted markets to 156. There'll be some adjacent markets with stations that infringe, if you will, upon the major markets, and those markets could be targeted depending upon what's required or how many stations are participating in the primary market. In analyzing the markets, there are 35 markets where more than half of the UHF stations that will be needed in order to achieve the spectrum clearing. This is whether it's 84 megahertz or 126. The markets are listed here on the center and right-hand side of your screen. The value, of course, is going to depend on how many stations are in a market, how many are participating, whether it's a move to VHF or whether it's going off the air, and whether or not the clearing target remains 126 megahertz or it's diminished down to 84. Most of this is spelled out in two different reports that have come out over the time called Green Hill Reports. The Green Hill Reports, the first one was issued in October of 2014. The second one was issued this past month, early February. And it's a sales pitch to get broadcasters interested in participating. It outlines what the highest or opening bid is likely to be, and also what the likely bid at the conclusion of the reverse auction is going to be. So what is TV spectrum repack? Well, it's pretty well defined by the commission. It's reorganizing the television stations in the broadcast television bands so that the stations remain on the air after the incentive auction occupy a smaller portion of the UHF band, thereby freeing up a portion for new wireless services. The band plan has been an issue over the last 2 years of debate. It's been specified in the public notice 14-191A1 that came out in December, and it defines the clearing targets of 84 and 126. The guard bands between wireless and TV services will be anywhere from 3 to 11 megahertz depending upon the actual clearing. There is a duplex gap between the wireless uplink and the wireless downlink channel assignments. That duplex gap is 11 megahertz. And one of the reasons for the clearing targets of 84 or 126 is to set up where the duplex gap will be in the consumer devices and also in the base stations for wireless. Once that's established, it's not easily moved without obsoleting the base station equipment as well as the consumer devices. The original intent was to not put any TV assignments into what's called impaired spectrum, and we'll do a deeper dive into impaired spectrum here shortly. However, because there may not be enough stations to reach either of these two clearings, there is a likely chance that some stations will be put into the wireless spectrum and thereby impairing it, a portion of it. And it is quite possible that part of the duplex gap will include some of the stations assigned to impaired spectrum. As I mentioned earlier, Channel 37 remains. It is no longer part of the TV service, and it will be protected on either side by 3 megahertz guard bands. Here's a snapshot look. As you can see, there are 4 segments, the 84, the 108, 114, and 126 clearing targets. And you'll see out to the far left the number of wireless channel pairs that are created by those individual clearing models. And you'll see the duplex gap, and you'll also see the guard bands. TV service remains in 6 megahertz. The guard band at the 84 megahertz clearing target is made up of 37 and 3 megahertz above, whereas in the case of clearing all the way down to channel 29, there's a 9 megahertz guard band between the top end of channel 29 and the first wireless assignment. So how many stations are directly impacted first? So if we look at the clearing targets, 84, 108, 114, 126, the highest remaining TV channels for 84 would be channel 36. For 126, it's 29. The stations that are station numbers that are directly impacted are shown on the right-hand side of your screen, 543 for 84, and for 126 megahertz, 860. Now, obviously, some of those stations are likely to be stations that go off the air or become channel sharing or go to VHF. But overall, the number of stations that are going to be directly impacted are listed there. There's also going to be indirect impact. Those stations that are in the lower UHF channels and perhaps even in the VHF that have to move to accommodate the stations that are being relocated out of the cleared spectrum. And if you add the two numbers together, the range looks to be somewhere in the neighborhood of between 800 and 1,200 stations overall that will be impacted. That's directly impacted and indirectly impacted. The next part of the modeling exercise was to look at how many UHF stations need to be eliminated to make the clearing target. So if we look at 84 megahertz, at the very bare minimum, we need 78 stations, and those have to be in the right markets, in the right parts of the country, to be eliminated in order to clear 84. But if we do that, if we only have 78 stations that participate, we're going to have many stations that end up in impaired spectrum. If we wanted no stations in the impaired spectrum range, there would have to be 414 stations, again, in the right locations, that are eliminated to accommodate an absolutely clear 84 megahertz block of spectrum. For 126 megahertz, 204 stations minimum, 670 stations eliminated to clear and have no impaired spectrum. The current pool of eligible UHF stations, if you look at full power in Class A, is 1,706 stations. Again, the maximum number is based on how many stations have to be eliminated in order to repack without impairing any spectrum. The minimum number is the absolute minimum number of stations that need to be eliminated, but there will be a number of stations left in impaired spectrum. So a quick look at impaired spectrum and the issues. One of the biggest issues is the risk of inter-service interference, either DTV to wireless or wireless to DTV, and that can be a combination of base station to DTV, for example, or portable devices to DTV, or vice versa, DTV to base stations, DTV to portable devices. There are four different models here that are illustrated. If we look at assignments in impaired spectrum, here's a station that's been assigned first of all, based on the 126 megahertz clearing, where 29 is the last permanently or fully assigned TV channel. We have a station now assigned to channel 30, and you'll see that that's a relatively easy situation because what you're really impairing there will be 6 of the 9 megahertz that makes up the guard band. And because the minimum amount of guard spectrum between TV service and wireless is 3 megahertz, and that extra 3 remains in the guard band, we're fine. We don't really do anything to any of the wireless channels when we operate as a channel 30 impairment. However, if we have a station that's assigned in, let's say, channel 43, we find that the station is partially into the 11 megahertz duplex gap. It also extends into a wireless channel, but because we need an additional 3 megahertz of guard spectrum, it's going to partially impair a second wireless channel. So there's a fair amount of impairment. And the impairment, by the way, will vary with distance from the television assignment. One of the questions we get asked frequently is, will stations that are not changing channels be impacted? How might they be impacted? Well, there are situations where if you share a tower, and you have stacked antennas, and you happen to be on, let's say, the top antenna in a stack, and the guy below you is the one who has to change out his antenna, you obviously are going to have an interruption. And that's going to require temporary antenna facilities in order for him to remove his antenna, put the new antenna in. Could be that you share a broadband antenna and transmission line and a combiner, all of which will have to be changed out. So those are examples of where you might have some impairments or impact. One of the issues that has yet to be resolved is who will pay to accommodate these stations during the process. There's been a suggestion that the station that's actually impacted the station is actually being repacked, will have to cover the cost in their budget for repack for the station that is indirectly impacted. So that's a case where you need to work with your partner in a shared antenna or tower situation. Staying on the air during repack, well, some of you have second transmitters, some of you have standby antennas. That certainly makes it a lot easier so that you can take one set of transmission equipment down, replace it or move it in channel assignment while the other remains in operation. But if you don't, you're very likely going to need a transmitter and a temporary antenna, feed line, et cetera, in order to make the move. One thing I want to point out is the FCC has not at this point ruled out the fact that you might actually have an interim channel assignment that you have to go to before your final channel assignment in the repack. Those are details yet to be worked out. We also have a repack timeline, and the repack timeline is being looked at very closely. The current timeline is a 39-month window with the first, well, first of all, the trigger point for that is when the forward auction is completed and the FCC releases a channel assignment for each of the stations that are remaining. At that point, the facility change freeze would end, and there would be a three-month window for stations to fill out a CP and an application, CP application, and also submit the application along with the budget for their proposed repack so that they can receive the 80% or 90% advanced payment to begin construction. If you're channel sharing, you have exactly 3 months, that three-month window, to implement the channel share and turn off the spectrum, the transmitter on the spectrum that has been relinquished. So it's an immediate process. Then there's a 36-month window following the 3 months of application time, and what remains to be stated is how long the commission is going to take to respond to the CP applications and issue an actual construction permit. A lot of speculation as to whether or not that can be done on a very quick turn basis, even though they're saying it can. So there's a 36-month window after that, and that window is when you construct the new facilities and make the appropriate move. At the end of the 36-month window, not the full 39 months, but 36 months from the time the auction is declared to be complete, you have to file an actual invoice to true up the cost of the repack. There's 3 more months remaining after that to complete the installation and to move to the new channel. If you're not moved to the new channel at the end of 39 months, the current rules state that you have to shut off your previous channel assignment and go dark. So it's a very onerous process to go through. And one of the real questions that has to be answered is whether or not the resources, particularly in the area of antennas, power work, power reconfiguration if necessary to strengthen towers, if all of that work can be accomplished in the appropriate time. And a lot of outside factors being looked at. For those of you who operate translators, again, if your translator is in a channel or a spectrum area that needs to be vacated, you will be able to remain until the new occupant of that spectrum is ready to go on air, and then the translator will have to be shut down. So the twist to all of this is, well, you've got a 39-month window. However, the commission has stated that they would like to not have everyone wait to the very end, so they're going to assign a timetable based on the factors of your individual station. So they might say to one operator, you have 12 months, another one 18 months, another one 30 months to make the transition. There seems to be no consideration for supplier deliveries, resources such as tower crews, local permitting, weather, all the uncontrollable factors that the station has to deal with. And they've also indicated that that one extension might be granted for due cause. So that remains to be seen as to how all this is going to work. I have a feeling that that's going to be a real area of trouble for the broadcasters. Paying for repack, of course, we know that Congress has set aside money, $1.75 billion. That money is for stations that are voluntarily moving as part of the, or I should say involuntarily moving. Stations that voluntarily move must pay for that out of their auction proceeds. So if you're forced to move, you're not participating in a channel change that you've elected to do, you're up for reimbursement. If you've elected to move to VHF, the money you get for moving from U to V, part of that money will have to pay for your actual move expenses. There's also a portion of the fund that will go to the multi-channel video providers who use your over-the-air signal as a source. And again, we bring up the issue of the stations that have been indirectly impacted that are currently not covered. Last year, there was a report commissioned by the FCC, the Widelity report, that was used to look at, first of all, what's the comprehensive list of reimbursable items, and what's the cost for each, review the proposed repack time, and determine if compensation fund is sufficient. We think that the items and the cost estimates seem to be on target. I've heard only a little bit of pushback from some of the tower folks. No compensation for business interruption, by the way. The 39-month repack window, we all believe, is going to be an issue. Widelity actually cited one case being Mount Sutro out in San Francisco, where they said at least 42 months, and we know of an issue out there where a station still waiting on a local permit to change out an antenna, been waiting for well over 2 years. They also pointed out that the reimbursement fund could support about 540 stations based on the modeling that they did. Well, we now know, based on current targets of 84 and 126, that 540 is likely to be a very low number. So it's quite possible that the compensation fund is insufficient. Here's a quick look at the proposed reimbursement items. Preparing for repack. We say start early. These are the things I think that you need to do. However, if you expect to be reimbursed for any of these things, they're not eligible for reimbursement. The eligibility for reimbursement begins when you have been told that you're being repacked, and you're absolutely certain that you're going to move. So this is an issue, again, I think that needs to be looked at. If there's any hope of doing this in 39 months, stations really need to get started early. So repack issues, again, timeline, is 39 months adequate? Reimbursement fund, is the fund sufficient? And the fact that you can't start the process ahead of being notified that you're repacking. I'm now going to pass the mic over to Joe Cecilia, and Joe's going to do a deep dive on the impact of the repack on the RF plant and its equipment. Joe?
All right, thank you, Jay. Excellent job there covering the basics of what's involved here. It seems like only yesterday, or maybe only a couple of weeks ago, it was 2006 and then 2009, when we were supposed to be done with the first transition. And so you might think that equipment in there is quite new, but you know, there are pioneers and early adopters in every transition, and a lot of that equipment went in like top 30 markets, 2001, 2002, and before. So there's been some changes. So let's take a look at how this might impact the transmitter plant. All right, so at very basic transmission system blocks, you know, we've got transmitter and its components, and then external RF items, the mass filter, in some cases an RF combiner, of course transmission line antenna to make up the RF plant. So what's impacted by the repack? And it's very likely that the transmitter's impacted, possibly low-pass filter, mass filter is likely, of course, if they're channelized. Combiner pretty much is going to be impacted if there is one. And transmission line, I've got a chart showing that you might think that the transmission line is good, but it might not be. And then the antenna, especially if it's a slot-style antenna that was cut to channel, if you're moving channel, it's no longer going to be right for your new plant. So, you know, ask yourself, is transmitter replacement necessary? You know, how many channels are you moving from the current assignment? And, you know, do you have a tube technology transmitter or a solid state transmitter, and we'll get into the impacts of each of those. And what about efficiency and power costs? And then, how are you going to stay on air during the repack process? So we wish changing channels of the RF plant and transmitter plant was as easy as it is at home with the remote control, but unfortunately, it's not. So let's take a look at a single collector IoT transmitter, one of the most popular transmitters out there, especially in major markets for maximized stations. So what components here might be impacted by a channel change? The exciters, intermediate power amplifiers. Some of these transmitters use circulators to protect the IPA from the tube drive. Circulators are frequency-dependent components. The IoT cavities are frequency-dependent items, although they're banded, but nonetheless, they don't cover the entire band. As well as coupling loops and cavity domes, low-pass filter, mass filter, Magic T, and of course there's retuning and power calibration and tube retuning, and these transmitters require expertise. Once you disturb the rig that's been running comfortably for a long time, you know, sometimes unexpected things happen, and tube experts are only getting rarer out there in the market. So a couple different types of IoTs to look at. The standard that was early adopted on the left, and then later, vendors came up with input cavity rearranged and was a bit easier to install and service, called the plug-in IoT. And there's several different models out there. However, above and right of that tube, there is a section that's called the breakaway, and there's a low-pass filter section above that as well sometimes. And those are frequency-dependent components. They're banded from channels 14 to 34, 35 to 52, and then 52 up. We can pretty much disregard 52 up going forward. And then if there's a retuning of this directional coupler to properly get your meter set up, that requires some precise equipment. So this isn't necessarily a job for someone without the right training. And there's different flavors of IoTs out there, and you have to assess which one you have. Do you have an L3? Do you have one of the newer energy-saving collector IoTs? Do you have one of the older style and a different brand, that may not be supported any longer? So, lead times and availability are very valid concerns here. Just some pictorial examples of banded transmitter parts. Circulators, even solid-state transmitters, that power amplifier module shown in the top center, was a banded design. So solid-state transmitters could have been banded for higher efficiency and power output, or broadband for convenience of channel change sake. And in the center bottom are cavity domes from IoT cavity, and you see the coupling loops there, the two different coupling loops for different bands. So just as an example, you could be in a situation where the power amplifier modules are in one band, the circulators that are used are in a different band. So you could be in a situation where you have to replace power amplifier modules and not circulators, or circulators and not power amplifier modules, or you have to replace them both. You just have to assess your situation with your manufacturer. High power RF systems definitely going to be needed to be changed out. Waveguide supports different frequencies, 1150 for the higher frequencies, 1500 in the middle, and 1800 for the low. The cavities are attuned to channel item. And in general, it should be safe assumption that a new RF system is going to be needed. I mentioned before the transmission line. So this is a chart from Dielectric on transmission line segments. There are 20-foot lengths, 19 and I can't read that very 19 and a quarter, and 19 and a half foot lengths. So if you're moving from channel 19, let's say, to channel 17, and you've got 20-foot sections on channel 19, you can't use that transmission line on channel 20. And that's all due to a phenomenon known as visuar buildup due to the flanges, 20-foot section. At each flange, there will be a little bit of standing wave ratio, and it multiplies up the tower, the length of the line. So you could be in a situation where, that transmission line is no longer just a passive element. It needs to change as well. So channel change or replace it. Got some really, really old rigs here, all, I think, out of service at this point in time. So look at the channel change cost versus new. You know, in some cases, the transmitter may be supported by the manufacturer for a repair or a one or a two needed replacement item here. But if the industry as a whole is to come to a manufacturer and need to be replaced, the manufacturer may not have support to completely redo that line. So there's going to be a cost there associated with it. In many cases, you know, a good argument can be made for replacement. Much higher efficiency technology in solid state. In some cases, you can save on electricity costs over 50%. This efficiency can also be somewhat broadband, so sparse consolidation is possible, especially if you're going to cooperate with a broadcaster and do channel sharing and so forth in the market. So long-term support's the key, and you know, I mentioned the tube prices and availability, and if we move to solid state, we take it to low voltage versus high voltage. So, you know, there's a little bit of a checklist over here. What's it going to cost to upgrade the transmitter or in the band, if I got to move out of band or a new transmitter? Look at the benefits. So like I said, some of these transmitters out there are approaching 15 years old or more, and while that might not meet your write down schedule, the market is forcing us to do some different things. Even VHF replacement with new is a consideration. In the VHF market, it's been solid state since the late 80s, early 90s, pretty much, and those transmitters are still out there, workhorses of the market. However, shown here is a new one on the right and an older one on the left, and the footprint is greatly reduced, as well as the efficiency. So, you know, from 20% efficiency to over 40% AC to RF efficiency. So, while you might not think that the power bill at VHF is that big of a deal to begin with, you're still going to reduce it a great amount and reduce the floor space. So in a shared facility, that's a big deal. So pricey efficiency equates to less than half the heat dissipated to the room. So there's added savings on HVAC costs that further improves your return on the investment. So this is an example, an old transmitter at 20% efficiency produces 24 kilowatts to the room. A new one at 40%, the heat load's 9. So the heat load of the room drops by 63%. So that is really going to help your overall total cost ownership going forward. What if we replace the IoT with solid state? You know, dramatic reduction in electrical power consumption, a much smaller footprint, safer with getting rid of the high voltage, broadband designs nowadays to minimize group spares holding, and just less maintenance. And you know, several of us have been out there when you know a tube has had an unexpected failure. And I don't know how many broadcasters out there on the webinar actually budget for a tube to be replaced. Typically, they're replaced only when failed, and then it's an unexpected OPEX. So we get rid of that. We also increase floor space or reduce floor space. On the left is what a single tube IoT transmitter takes up. The control cabinet, the transmitter cabinet, voltage regulator, line control cabinet, the high voltage beam supply, pump module, heat exchanger, all of those components just to run a single tube amplifier. It's equivalent in a modern solid-state transmitter shown on the right. Two cabinets of a transmitter, a much smaller pump module, and it's high efficiency. It has a smaller heat exchanger as well. So you can save over 50% on real estate in the room. So as a summary, from IoT to solid state, high efficiency without high voltages, basically, and broadband for future channel change, no tube replacement, easier maintenance, longer coolant life, lower temperature, a lot less stress. We don't have cooling anymore on the collector of the tube itself. So it's much more tolerant. We can even replace older solid-state UHF transmitters. So there's a dramatic reduction in electrical power consumption, and as well as broadband design. Again, less maintenance. And if we look at one of our newer transmitters compared to the older transmitter that was a workhorse during the original DTV transition for broadcasters in the lower power transmitter power output category, there is a savings of 87% floor space compared with the transmitter that it replaces. So I hope this animation is coming up okay on the webinar. Seemed like it worked a bit fairly well. But if we look at an old transmitter, a DHD90, we can fit 5.5 racks in the same space that that transmitter fit in. So again, real estate savings, especially in a shared facility, is a big deal. So we can more than double the efficiency and increase the power savings, floor space recovery, and we don't have external frequency-dependent combiners, simple maintenance, and liquid-cooled versus air-cooled. The transmitter that I showed you, the solid-state replacement, was an air-cooled transmitter being replaced with a liquid-cooled transmitter. So 90% of any waste heat is transferred outside. So again, that's going to reduce your HVAC costs in the building. So the key takeaways we'd like to end with here with everybody is that all stations are possible repack candidates, not just people who want to raise their hand and participate in the auction. If you're down at channel 20 and you feel that you're safe and you could be in a market adjacent to a big market that's going to be impacted by some outside influence, some other repack in the bigger market. All stations are a possible repack candidate, not just volunteer stations. So staying on air during repack will most likely require additional facilities, and converting from U to V will impose future limitations on your coverage and ability to deliver mobile service. So think about that option to go to V if you want viable mobile service to be part of your future. And channel sharing, if you choose to do that, could limit your future ability to deliver mobile, multi-channel, and 4K, aka Ultra HD TV services. And if you're interested in channel sharing, find your partner, start negotiating immediately. The deal must be signed before the auction starts, and you must be ready to address any community of license issues. And if you're interested in participating in the auction, pay close attention to the anti-collusion rule. It's pretty much a strict NDA of not talking and sharing about what you're doing in the market. It strictly bars communication among any broadcasters, so if you're in that situation, be mindful. So at this point in time, we'd like to open it up to any questions here on the chat, and we'll be glad to answer them.
Hey, Jay, do you see John Bates' question?
I see John's question, yes. So I think the answer to that is we don't know at this point. Certainly the intent is to replicate what you have today. However, there is also the possibility of interference, and I believe that the rules limit the amount of interference. So there is a possibility that that you could withstand a minor reduction in power as well as perhaps going through maximization. We're just going to have to wait and see. Those are part of the unanswered items that we expect answers for over the next roughly 6 months. Talking to our legal counsel at Wiley Rhine, they're closely watching and feeding information back to us.
Okay, we've got another question from Rich Plotkin asking, are the vendors such as GatesAir ready to manufacture the required equipment for the repack? Well, we're doing our best to ramp up, and during the original build-out for the DTV conversion, we ran a couple of shifts in our plant and did everything we could to deliver things on time. I imagine the other manufacturers are looking at doing the same thing. We do everything we can to get all the equipment there. I think one of the bigger bottlenecks that Jay alluded to really is the availability of qualified people to do tower work, antenna work, and transmitter installation work.
And also, it's been pointed out to me, particularly by the structural folks, that there are some towers out there that are going to have to be modified. And when a modification is involved, it's a fairly lengthy project. I talked to a fellow yesterday who pointed out that, for example, bridge strand, which is used for guying towers, in some cases where a tower gets beefed up, guys are going to have to be replaced and increased in strength. Bridge strand could be at least a year from the time you order it until delivery. There are few manufacturers, and those that are out there do everything to order. There's nothing sitting on the shelf that you can pick up a few thousand feet of cable and string guys. They're all made to order, so that's going to be a factor. Our best count is there are 13 tower crews, and we're looking at what it takes to do individual projects. Keep in mind that it's not really a 36-month window because you have to order an antenna. It has to be built. You have to order your transmitter. It has to be built. So all these things arrive on site much later, and that's when the services folks would kick in. So it's very doubtful at this point that there are enough service organizations to be able to get everything done in the time window.
Hey, Jay, Mark Felix asked us about tying in ATSC 3.0 for repack. Very, very popular topic in these hallways and other hallways.
Yes, it is. I would say there are two things working in the background, Mark. There seems to be a movement amongst some broadcasters to not support that, and the reason for that is there are some broadcasters that have elected to participate in the auction process, and they do not want a transition to 3.0 to tie up or delay the auction process. That seems to be one factor. The other is that the commission is, at this point, really not been willing to listen to that that argument. I personally believe it's it would be a good thing for the industry to do all this at once. However, in the opportunity that presents itself with repack, this is the time to prepare your plant for future 3.0. So the transmitter you pick, the exciter that you pick in the new transmitter, all of those need to be able to support a future ATSC 3.0 implementation. Joe, I see a question also that was about the M2X exciter and whether or not it's capable of changing frequencies. You're the M2X expert. I'll let you answer that one.
Yeah, the M2X is indeed frequency agile. However, it remains to be, since the standard is not on paper yet, there are a lot of aspects of the 3.0 system that aren't defined. So we're assessing that platform's extensibility to 3.0 at this point in time. So we're not in a position to say whether or not it will be able to leap to 3.0 or whether a newer exciter will be required to support 3.0. We've done some testing with 3.0 with some of our partners. However, it's not you know, the front end was from the partner, and the M2X exciter was on the back end. It wasn't a complete signal processing chain. So it remains under, you know, evaluation as the standard solidifies.
There's a question, Joe, about if repeaters. This gentleman points out that they were able to install some repeaters to cover the areas that they lost in the analog to digital transition, and will that remain the case in Repack? The real question there will be, will there be sufficient spectrum to put those repeaters on if they are, in essence, translators? If they are on-channel repeaters, that is probably a greater possibility, and certainly a much easier possibility if we were do this in ATSC 3.0.
Right, Jay, and Mark has commented too that last week Bill Lake of the FCC said that yes, that is actually going to be the case. And as you mentioned, with ATSC 3.0 looking at you know, an OFDM-based system, much friendlier to work with from a on-air repeater point of view. To we don't have a ghosting issue. You know, so on-channel repeaters become much easier to deal with. Known pretty much to the industry in the OFDM world and DVB-T world, ISDVB-T world as gap fillers. So with an OFDM-based system, certainly makes that easier.
Dennis Wallace asked a question here about any idea about the LPTV channel displacement process and how this fits in with the 36-month time frame. Nothing firm, Dennis, but I believe that when the channel gets reassigned and the station is ready to come on the air, that at that point the LPTV would have to vacate the channel, much the same way that the translators will have to vacate when their spectrum is lit up by the new user of the spectrum. But I don't know of any specific rules that mention LPTV. I'm sure that that will happen. As you know, there's a lot of consternation amongst the LPTV owners over the fact that they're not included and there's really no rules and regulations covering what their future might look like.
Okay, well, we've reached the end of our allotted time for the webinar. I'd like to thank everybody for, I guess we need a new cliche for the term dialing in. We'll be on the lookout for that. So appreciate everyone's joining the webinar today, and we'll say thank you very much from GatesAir. And this session has been recorded by us and will be placed on our YouTube channel for later if you want to go over it again.
Okay, I'll just add one, if I could, in the shameless commerce department area, Joe. We will be giving a presentation on Repack at NAB during the Broadcast Engineering Conference in April out at Las Vegas. So we look forward to seeing many of you there, and hopefully you'll have some additional material. I will have with us a partner on the process, Ari Meltzer from Wiley-Line. Ari will be able to do a deeper dive on some of the legal and procedural activities. So we look forward to seeing you in April. Thank you.